All right, turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, we are on part 32. And the title of the message is Distinctions Between Election and Predestination. Distinctions Between Election and Predestination. I'm just warning you ahead of time. Don't expect this to be some type of advanced college level theological lecture. Because you know I don't like talking over people's heads. I'm going to try to make it simple, show a few distinctions of what I've noticed, and hopefully this will be helpful. Romans 8, a common place to start is verse 28, so we'll do that. We'll read to the end of the chapter. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. For whom He foreknew, He also predestinated to be conformed to the image of His Son, for Him to be the firstborn among many brethren. Whom He predestinated, these He also called. And whom He called, those He also justified. And whom He justified, these He also glorified. What shall we say to these things? Primarily talking about the things we just mentioned. Those five things, sometimes called the golden chain of grace. Sometimes called that by some people. Some of you made faces like you never heard that before. If God is for us, who can be against us? Truly, truly, He did not spare His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all. And He's writing to the Romans, those that believe the gospel. That's who us all is. How shall He not with Him freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifies. Who is He condemning? It is Christ that died, but rather has raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword? As it is written, speaking of the Old Testament, it's written there, this. For your sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep of slaughter. But in all things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we'll end our reading there. Now, we're getting ready to shift into dealing with, as a comparison to the elect, we're going to deal with the non-elect, not this message, maybe some of this message, but that's what we're shifting towards. And I think I had brought this up a week or two ago, that when we do this, it's going to cause a few things. It should. Humility and gratitude. And in a major way. And when we look at it, I think you'll see and experience it when we go through it as we talk about it. Today I want to look at the relationship just briefly between election and predestination and show a few distinctions. I kind of jokingly brought up something when I was reading. I said some would call this, these five things, the golden chain of grace. And I said it on purpose. I want to talk about how that people talk about things by using phrase terms and different things. The point is they use a bunch of different phrases and terms, and everybody uses different. And this is just common in life, whether it be in your own family. You have a family language. I know I did growing up, you know, and every great once in a while you'll find somebody else, maybe somebody that I work with, and I'll hear a couple phrases that maybe was I only thought was in our family, and I, you know, come to find out, well, his dad's probably from the same place my dad was from, you know what I mean, or my mom or whatever. And so we have family language. Sometimes you have, I knew this guy when I was in junior high. I went over to his house and listened to him and his family talk. I could not understand a word. They just crazy talk. I'm thinking, it's in my neighborhood. It's not a different country. I could not understand half of what they were saying. They had a family language. You go to your workplace, and I'm a trainer at work. So as people come in, I train them different things, mainly crane training nowadays. So the what's called nomenclature, if anybody wants to know what that is, ask Rob, he'll tell you afterwards. The naming of things is what that means. But the naming of things in training is pretty important, because if somebody is talking about a sander and you're talking about a grinder, you think you're talking about two different things, but, well, the place this guy worked at, that's what he called it, but it was the same thing. And on and on and on. Any type of business or this, that, and the other, there's language that goes with everything. And it's weird how that sometimes people use different terms to mean the same thing. Theology, doctrine is no different. And it's okay to a certain extent as long as people know what's being talked about. That's the main thing. There has to be an understanding of what's being communicated. I mean, you can call a chair a number 7 if you want. As long as you know it's the same thing, it doesn't really matter, I don't think. There's so many distinctions and changes in this, even Bible versions. I know I was reading from the modern King James Version. And sometimes when I'll switch versions, and sometimes I'll be reading the King James, and I'll change it when a word comes up to the modern King James, or I'll be reading the modern King James and I don't like how it's expressed, and I'll know what it says in the King James and I'll add it in there. It's terms, phrases, definitions, and so on. We do it all the time. And again, there's nothing wrong with it as long as we know what's being said, what it means. Words are one thing, but meanings are quite another thing. That's the important part, is the meanings. So depending on what denomination or group or location, Bible version, all these different things, some people are going to be more loose with their language of how they talk about things than other people's likings. And somebody might make a mountain of a molehill, like, you have to call it this, you know what I mean? And a lot of times it's weird that... And I'm going to pick on the King James only people. I'm not talking about King James Bibles, but the King James only crowd is a different crowd. And they will act like that nobody was converted before 1611. I mean, I've not had one answer that question yet. Like, how is that possible that anybody was saved before 1611? But anyway... they will make a mountain out of a molehill when it comes to certain terms and phrases. But yet, they'll stop and they'll explain what a word in the King James means. I don't know why they do that, you know, because they're messing with the authorized version of that word, as if Jesus Christ spoke English. Shakespearean, Elizabethan English. He didn't. He spoke these other languages that we have to take and translate. So I think you get the picture. So some of this might be attributed to laziness, ignorance, or stubbornness. And I have a tendency to all three of those things. You know, somebody, I know I've had several conversations. If any of you know me and my wife, we're always like poking at each other, you know, sense of humor wise. And so we have a lot of discussions, I'll call them that, about words, you know. And she'll tell me that I'm mispronouncing something or saying, you know, and I just say, yeah, I don't care. I'm not going to change. I don't care. Certain things I say wrong, you know, a pillow. I call it a pillow, P-E. I don't care. It's what I call it all my life. I'm not changing. I'm not repenting from calling it that. I don't care. But I think when it comes to other things too, terms and phrases that are more important than a pillow versus a pillow, I'm kind of lazy and ignorant and stubborn about some of those too. But anything to do with theology, sometimes there are pronunciations. I've noticed people in here pronounce different theological terms different than me, and I don't, you know, climb up their back and say, yeah, you're pronouncing it wrong, you know. Or, yeah, I might be wrong. I know what you're saying, but it's just pronounced different. People have different accents. They have different nicknames for things, right? You've heard me talk about sovereign grace, Calvinist reform. I named those three things to cover talking about people to believe the doctrines of grace, those 5 points. And I'll use those three things to make sure that everybody listening knows what I'm talking about. You know my preference, sovereign grace, over Calvinism or reform. You know why. People on video might not know the whole history of why. I could talk about it forever, why. But again, different choices for using different terms. I'll give you some silly examples of family terms. I remember when Whitney is our oldest. She's, what are you, Whitney, 33? 32. She used to watch cartoons. Betty Boop, that's an old one. And I think we had cable TV at some point in time, and she was wondering at times, is it cable TV or is it a video? And she would say, for cable, she would say channel or Beto. And we would say, you know, we would go ahead and use her term, it's channel. That means it's TV. And we would go ahead and use Beto. Now, you know what? We still use that Beto phrase today. And Calvin early on had a hard time saying vitamins. He said vimes. Still use it today. So I think in families, sometimes we do that. And I know workplaces, I'll see a guy that I worked with 20 or 30 years ago and see him in a store, and he'll use some goofy phrase, bring back the memory. Okay, yeah, the camaraderie, I get it. So that's the idea. Sometimes we bring those things back out of the archives. Now, theologically, those things happen too. So I want to cut to the chase here and just again, when I deal with people, I don't expect to be agreed with. I mean, new people especially. I mean, it's a surprise when somebody agrees with me on anything to do with Scripture. It's a big surprise. But my main goal is to be understood. That's my main goal. I have to be clear. I'm not going to lie to anybody. And I don't want to powder puff it or cut off the rough edges. I have to speak the truth in clarity. And my goal is to be understood. And if somebody agrees with me, I consider it a miracle. So these are things that have to do, again, with terms and phrases and definitions and meanings and so on and so forth. Ephesians, let's go ahead and go to Ephesians. We will come back to Romans. Ephesians chapter 1. We're just going to look at primarily two texts, Romans 8 and Ephesians 1. Both of them have the idea of election and predestination in them, and we just want to talk briefly. We are going to go to Acts 2 and 4 later to talk about predestination of things or events. Ephesians 1:3, we'll read through verse 6, and we'll go to verse 11. Just want to do an overview of the use of the terms. We're very familiar with these verses. Blessed be, verse 3, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who blessed us with every spiritual blessings in the heavenlies in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. So there's your election. According as the Father has chosen the elect in Christ, in him, before the foundation of the world. So there's election. That we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us, there's our predestination. As we've said before, we always want to look at what we're being predestinated according to or to. Here it is. To the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself. And notice, has nothing to do with free will. According to the good pleasure of his will. To the praise and the glory of his grace, in which he has made us accepted in the beloved, in Christ. Okay, so there we have in verse 4, election, and verse 5, predestination. Now go down to verse 11. It's going to mention predestination and then some things after that. In whom, speaking of Christ, we have been chosen to an inheritance, being predestinated. So there is election again, chosen, and notice, to an inheritance. Being predestinated according to what? The purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his own will. So there again, election and predestination coupled together there in verse 11 and in verse 4 and 5. So from the Romans 8 text and this Ephesians 1 text, we see a mix of words, but yet they're distinct. There is the choosing or choice itself, and then there is an assigning of those persons to a destination or blessing. Notice verse 4 again. He chose us in him, in Christ, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, I'm going to be bouncing back and forth between Ephesians and Romans 8. And I apologize for that. It's easy for me. I've got it cut and pasted in front of me. I don't have to turn back and forth. It's already there. You probably have most of these memorized. But I wanted to show back in our what we introduced the text in verse 29 of Romans 8, election and predestination there. And it just doesn't flat out say election. It's talking about foreknowledge. And we covered foreknowledge already in our series. Verse 29, for whom he foreknew, he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son, for him to be the firstborn among many brethren. Again, not just flat out predestination, period. Just raw predestination and just like, of what? Of nothing? No. Right here. To be conformed to the image of his son. So there's something that trails, that's a purpose that God's going to accomplish in reference to those who are predestinated. Now the word foreknew, we've already covered this. It's prognosko. It's coming from two words, two original words. And it has to do, the pro is for or before, and gnosko has to do with knowledge. So it's to know before, to foresee, to foreknow, to ordain, or to know before, know beforehand. And we went into some pretty good detail, I thought, back then in the earlier part of the series, talking about there is an affection related to this, of God knowing people ahead of time, and we are nowhere near done with this, because when we talk about reprobation, we're going to talk about God not knowing people, and we're going to cover that in a little bit more detail the next few weeks, and you'll see I held back some because I knew we were going to cover the other half in the non-elect. So we talked about how there is a previous affection or love or relation connected to this word. Also, other texts have to do with an appointment or a ordaining connected to this word. So this is in Romans 8, where it names these five things. There is an order in it. I know some Greek scholars are going to freak out because it's everything's talking about in the past tense. I'm not denying it's in the past tense. God speaks in the past tense because He's eternal and His thought is one thought. And it's already taken place. I know we can't deal with that because we can't get ahead of it like God already knows everything all at once. He is eternally omniscient. He doesn't have a new thought. So He's able to do this and we aren't. So when He speaks of this salvation, the breadth of salvation from before time, coming into time, and after time, these five things are spread that far and encompasses most of what salvation is. He speaks of it as already a done deal. And again, I already explained why, because of the way He thinks. But the idea of God effectually getting stuff done, I believe, is the point. It's just as good as already done anyway, because of who He is and the ability to follow through with this. We can look at it and say, it's going to get done because of who He is and the way He thinks and the way He follows through and has the power and the sovereignty to get it done. We also saw promises connected with it. He promised, the God that cannot lie, promised eternal life before time. Also, in reference to the covenant, He swore to Himself. That's a big deal. So all this language over the top concerning God is going to get it done. So us little humans, as we enter into statements that are stated in the past tense, we have to compare Scripture with Scripture and figure out what's being talked about. It's our responsibility to interpret it. So, again, God being all-knowing has no new thought, especially since we know He has already purposed all things. So before He said this, He purposed it before He even said it. So if He purposed it, we know back then what He said was already the case. I mean, that's even true with us. Before we say something, we think it. That's why we say sin is from the heart before it's committed with whatever, the hands or whatever, or the eyes or the mouth or whatever. You can't get ahead of God. So God has known unto Him as all His works from the foundation of the world. He has done everything perfectly. He will not fail. There's no second thoughts. There's no plan Bs. He's got it all in control. So this is kind of what we're going to be dealing with when we talk about some of these things concerning predestination. Now, verse 28, we want to just read over this again. I want us to notice the people that's being talked about. Besides God, the people. Verse 28, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love God. Now, before we go any further, we read in Ephesians 1:11 that He works all things after the counsel of His own will. See the connection here? We know that all things work together. This is the God that works all things together for the counsel of His own will. Harmonious verses, two different books, saying the same thing, agreeing, no contradictions. They work together for a specific group of people, for those who love God. Now, I'm going to use this verse when we deal with the non-elect And I'm going to do a versification and change the words referring to the non-elect. I think I'm allowed. So we'll save that for the next week or two. It goes on to kind of emphasize more who these people are. The ones that love God, and it kind of just reiterates who they are, to those who are called according to his purpose. Now, calling is on down in a couple verses here. It's going to say it again, talk about calling. So he sets it up talking about the people. He's talking about the elect and not the non-elect, in other words. Verse 29. We had talked about how that the opposition believes that God foresees something that's done in people. The Arminian doctrine, we said, teaches that God looks down to the future to see what they will do. But this verse here deals with people explicitly. Just people. Doesn't talk about actions. Now, we also have a harmonious verse, Romans 9:11. For the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil. So the purpose of God, according to election and predestination, it matches these verses here. For whom he foreknew, he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of his son, for him to be the firstborn among many brethren. So we have the whom. It's talking about a group of people. Same group of people in verse 28, those that love God who are the called according to his purpose. Same ones that he's writing to in this church, those that are saints, believers, sanctified, justified, so on. So notice as we go through here, there is an order. First, there is foreknew or foreknown or foreknowledge, the doctrine of foreknowledge, referring to people whom he foreknew. Not what people would do. We already know what everybody's going to do. They're going to sin. Everybody. We already know because of total depravity what they can't do. They can't naturally come to God. There's none that seeketh after God. There's none good, none righteous. There's none that understandeth. So we already know those two things. They can't come to God, and they're going to sin. So this is talking about people whom God foreknew or had this love directed toward, affection set on. So there is that relationship. They're chosen in Christ because of love. Those people, what did he do? He predestinated them. So there's this previous activity. And then that leads to this next activity. Those he foreknew, he's not going to leave them there. Because he foreknew them, he's going to follow through with something else. This is part of the spiritual blessings. Spoken of in Ephesians 1:3. So what God wants is his chosen people to be conformed to the image of Christ. So he's going to get this done because he loves them, because he foreknew them. So foreknowledge here, the love is directly hooked up with election. When God is loving people, he's choosing people. We've said this before too, and this is, I think it might help to relieve some of the confusion, is the timing of election. Now we know the scripture talks about it's before the foundation of the world. But since God is eternal, God has one perfect, omniscient, finished thought, we know that God's love is eternal. In other words, God has always loved the elect in Christ. So what this means is, there was, I jokingly say it, because most people are visual, and I think of it when people talk about it, they almost act as if God kind of like huddled in the Trinity and said, okay, let's get together, let's embark on this. And in other words, there was a place in eternity when God did this. This is eternal. This language is just for us to know that it was done, not that when we can like visualize this taking place. God said it. It's in his mind eternally. He always thought it. It's not like a fresh idea, in other words. That's the point. It's not a fresh idea. So because he previously loved these people, he followed through to predestinate them to be conformed to the image of his son. Now, the predestination in Ephesians talked about to the adoption of sons and some other things, to an inheritance. It mentions some other things. So we see that my introduction, I talked about words and how that, I don't think I brought this up, they possibly start to overlap sometimes and bring in other things with them. And we're going to, I'll get to some of those words here in a minute. Verse 30, whom he predestinated, these he also called. He mentioned up there in verse 28 that he's specifically talking about the ones who are the called. King James says the called, definite article. Those who are called. And then whom he called, those same ones are justified, and whom he justified, these same ones he also glorified. And again, all past tense spoken of. So, we always should talk about the fact that these five things, foreknowledge, predestination, calling, justification, and glorification, the same people are included in all of it. He starts out with the group of people that are the elect, and those same people are carried over to each one of these things. None are dropped off along the way. The same amount that started with is the same amount that's ended, and they all got each one of those things on the way through. It's the whole of salvation. Nobody gets parts of salvation skipped, is what we're getting at. So, having seen that and said that, I think we can easily hook up foreknew with love and election. And then predestination comes after. And that seems to be the order in Ephesians also. We talk about unconditional election, meaning not conditioned on our merit or God foreseeing what we would do. In other words, believe. So that's why we talk about it's not conditioned on that. This is exactly why Arminianism says that it is conditioned on, and they'll use the word foreknowledge. They'll say election is conditioned on foreknowledge, and they'll explain it's God looking down through the future. And we reject that. So the Arminian God uses man's choice to react to as the ground or basis as his own choice. And they see that as fair. I mean, they really do. With their human logic, they think, well, this is the fairest way that it can be. Therefore, if you don't choose, it's your fault. Right? They humanly think that. Now, again, we know the real biblical position of election, that it's in him, it's conditioned on Christ alone. In other words, the manner in which the elect are chosen is in him. Now, besides that, we know that it wouldn't work, and I kind of alluded to this a second ago, it wouldn't work when the Arminian says, this is the fairest way, we just have to let man do it, and if man fails, it's man's fault. We know it wouldn't work because of man's total inability to even know or choose God, because of man's dead state that he's in. He's naturally dead in his trespasses and sins. He doesn't seek after God. He has no spiritual knowledge at all. Zero. None. To even form a decision to approach Christ. Doesn't even have the knowledge to gather up to even be qualified to make a decision. So we can just outright say, first of all, the scripture doesn't even say what you're saying, Arminian. This is the way it's done. It's in, by, and through Christ. And besides that, your way wouldn't work because of total depravity. I mean, that's a two-pronged thing that just clobbers Can't use that word. Clobbers, destroys their view as being just ridiculous. So therefore, we know that election cannot be conditioned on a wrongly defined foreknowledge. But this is when people kind of start arguing about terms and make a mountain out of a molehill. Like, you can't say that. Well, here we go. Can we biblically say that God's election is conditioned on real foreknowledge? Defining what foreknowledge is, God loving people beforehand in a relational way, and then God choosing them because of that and predestinating them because of that. Can we say that election is conditioned on foreknowledge? I want to say, yeah, if it's that kind of foreknowledge defined in a biblical way, but not the kind the Arminian says of God looking down through the future. That's just like saying, I believe in unconditional election. And somebody might be a smart aleck and say, oh, you don't believe election's conditioned on Christ? Oh, yeah, I do. Yeah, I do. You see what I mean? We have to just, who are we conditioning things on? Where the point is, it's not on man and it's on Christ. So when we get technical with our language, we have to talk like that, I guess, and go the extra mile to say what something is and what something is not, so we're not misunderstood. Another example of talking like that, talking about salvation, is an Old Testament verse quoted in Romans, talking about a righteousness apart from the law. And I would say that the law is involved. Christ does something with the law in salvation. We know one thing, he satisfies it. Now, when it says apart from the law, it's talking about apart from us doing something with the law. Christ better do something with the law. If I'm able to have the law satisfied, so I have to have that happen so I can get in with him, right? So people can get ridiculous and say a righteousness apart from the law and say, it's even talking about Christ not dealing with the law. That's not true. That's not true. It's talking about us not dealing with the law. It's two different things. So now here we also know about and talk a lot about and have for years the absolute sovereignty of God. And when we say that, we expand the placement of God's sovereignty from starting with his decree, his purpose, his will, his counsel before time, in creation, in his running of providence, controlling creation and people, in sovereignty in salvation of people, and sovereignty in the reprobation. It covers all those things. So here's the question. When we start using terms that are involved in God's absolute sovereignty, we do have overlap. And in different Bible translations, we actually hear words and see words that sound a lot different, but sometimes they're the original Greek word. Now, Ephesians 1, 4, and 5 talks about, according as he's chosen us in him for the foundation of the world, having predestinated us. So again, cause and effect. In verse 4, you have the choosing. Verse 5, you have the furthering of that, and a specific thing mentioned, predestinating us to the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself according to the pleasure of his goodwill, and how we're seen by the glory of his grace. We're accepted in the beloved. So these are the things we're predestinated to because we're chosen in him. So again, that's more cause and effect. So we see foreknowledge comes before election, and then election comes before predestination. Knowing that it's conditioned on Christ, in other words, the manner in which, because of his foreknowledge or previous love or relation to his people His affection has been set on His people in, by, and through Christ. Not just election is in, by, and through Christ, but love is in, by, and through Christ. We read that in verse 39 of Romans 8. The love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So, verse 11. Spend a little bit of time talking about something broader than just predestination connected to salvation. Expand it on out a little bit. Verse 11 says in Ephesians 1, in whom, in Christ, we also have been chosen to an inheritance, being predestinated, that's one thing, according to, and here's the rest of it, the purpose of Him, and we have to take this before the foundation of the world, predestination is too, purpose of Him, and then it defines who He is by what He does. This one, who works all things according to the counsel of His own will. This just is pregnant with sovereignty, just like sovereign, the sovereign God, the only one available. Here He is. All right, so the words and ideas should like flood your mind, and there should be a lot of overlap. You got predestination, will, purpose, decree, ordain, foreordain, appoint, determine, predetermine, counsel. All these words, and there's more than that. But it has to do with people, events, and things. This is God's absolute sovereignty. I know we talk about sovereignty and salvation because we deal with this in a gospel context most of the time. But when it deals with events and things, we want to see that this is the means that's predestinated for all these other things to take place. So God predestinates His people to be saved through these five things, but all in between, there are predestinated means that He controls. He's created, He controls through His providence. Can you separate who you are and your salvation from things and events? I mean, you can't even, apart from salvation, you can't do that with anything, right? You just, I mean, you are, therefore you move around and do things, right? I don't want to get too abstract, but, and I don't know why people want to like take means out of the way and act like, well, he's not part of that. Sometimes they might think this way. They might think, well, you know, that's, I've heard people say this, God's too busy to worry about that. As if, I've said it before, you know, God is like, He only has so many gigabyte and processing speed, you know what I mean, like a computer. It's not that way. We have talked about in times past that, just name it, everything without exception, I don't care what you name, God controls it. Stuff you can't see, stuff that they don't even have microscopes or telescopes for, God is running it right now and always has. Now, that is scary to people. That's scary to people. But what's weird is God's people should like rest in that. It's scary to people who don't like God's sovereignty because they like being in control. But God's people now that know this sovereign God that saved them, they should like, anxiety should go away. This is, God's absolute sovereignty is my chill pill. Should be. Now and forever. That's what He says throughout the scripture. Talks about a sparrow, the grass is, and the flowers, they're taken care of, a sparrow, a hair from a head doesn't fall, you know, all that stuff. Did the Holy Spirit waste God's breath in saying that? That's there for us to stop worrying about goofy stuff. We're not even supposed to be worrying about what we put on and what we eat. We're to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. I already thought about what I was going to eat before I got here for lunch. I shouldn't be thinking about that. That's why I need to lose like 30 or 40 pounds. All right, so we often, again, interchange or exchange words in a conversation about God's absolute sovereignty. And in Bible, again, Bible versions do that too. So can we say this? Can we ask this question? Can we say that God predestinated a storm? Say there was a bad storm that ripped through here last night. Can we say God predestinated it? Is it okay to use that phrase? There are other words that use the same Greek word that you could supplement and use those that might be more clearer, more biblical, precise, without people jumping on your back about it. But I don't have a problem with saying a storm is predestinated. It shows God controls it. It was God's purpose all the way through concerning His providence to let it do whatever it does. And if you just think practically, a storm usually moves. So it went from that destination to that destination. And it was predetermined to go there before it went there. And who do you think's running it? God is. So it's okay, I think, you know, to say, sure. God's the God of the whirlwind. He controls all that anyway. We know Satan doesn't control the weather, like the Pentecostals say. So things, through providence, have destinations. A leaf blowing. It's going to blow. It's going to stop and disintegrate somewhere, but it's wherever it stops, how many places it stops, whether it whips up in the air, it's all, God controls it all. It's got a destination. It gets scary to people, though, when it's something negative. A lot of religious people say, you know, God just predestinates the good things, and, you know, bad storms, especially if they hurt people. Rain, yeah, we'll say God controls that, gives us rain so flowers can grow and food can grow. But then they talk about a flood. They want to, that's Satan. Satan did that. You know what I mean? So anything negative, they seem to want to, like, they don't want to make God out to be a monster. It's a fundamental misunderstanding of a lot of things to make statements like that. So all things, without exception, we know ahead of time are fixed by God. And if people don't, again, if they don't hold to that truth, the result is talking about things that may be out of control. They might use phrases like luck. And then again, other things, they might feel like they have some control, which would result in their anxiety because they can't control such things. It includes bad things. It includes evil things. And we'll look at some of those in the weeks to come, what people consider bad or evil. And we'll look at the Scripture, exactly what is called evil in the Scripture, and show that God is sovereign over all of that. Can we say that God predestinated the cross? He predetermined it. I don't have a problem with using the word predestination. I don't have a problem with using all those words I listed up there a second ago. Predestination, will, purpose, decree, ordain, foreordain, appoint, determine, predetermine, counsel. All those things were involved in the cross. And we can use those words freely. Go to Acts chapter 2. And we'll look at, we looked at one of these recently. We'll look at Acts 2:23, and then we'll go to Acts 4. Acts 2:23, him being delivered, how? How was Christ delivered, in other words, handed over to have something done to him, to be crucified? I brought this up last week in the message, which was entitled, Christ in the Hands of an Angry God, showing that God was directly involved in The crucifixion of Christ. Him being delivered, how? By the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. Determinate is the word horizo. It's predestinate is prohorizo. So the pro is taken off before. And horizo, referring to, it's where we get the word horizon, which has to do with a line, a border, where God would cut off a line. And that's what he does when he controls things. He fences things. He borders things. He'll have something go so far and stop. This is the idea of determination. And then the other words, counsel, and then, of course, the word foreknowledge. So three words, determinate, counsel, foreknowledge. So these are things that are involved in God predestinating or predetermining the cross. It says, you have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. Now, some people, they might technically say, okay, well, God's the first cause and he used the secondary cause of the wicked hands that were taken to crucify and slain. You can talk like that. I don't care. Main thing is God's in charge of this. This is his will. This is his purpose. And I've said that this is what the world was created for, so that this can happen, because it's God's overarching purpose to glorify himself in the death of Christ. Chapter 4, Acts 4, and this will be, I believe, the last text we'll look at. Same type of idea, same language of God controlling things, especially the cross. Acts 4:26, the kings of the earth stood up, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For of a truth, against the holy child Jesus, whom you have anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the people of Israel, were gathered together. Look at the conspiracy. All the people that maybe not weren't necessarily buddies together before, but hey, let's get together now. We don't like this guy. They gathered themselves together, and the heathen raged. Right? I don't have it cut and pasted, but I'm pretty sure up in 25, it's quotes. What is that? Psalm 1 or 2. But anyway, they all gathered together against this one, against the Christ. To do what? Verse 28. For to do whatsoever your hand, notice hand, that refers to he's the prime mover, right? He's in control. No one shall stop his hand, it says in Daniel, or ask him or say to him, what are you doing? Daniel 4:35. Isaiah, 46, 9 through 11, same thing. All these strong Old Testament sovereignty of God classic texts that we go to. So there's the hand. To do whatsoever your hand and your counsel, this has to do with his mind, his purpose, his decree, determined, there's prohorizo. It's the same Greek word as predestinate. What's your hand and your counsel predestinated before to be done? So these are things that we can say God predestinated or predetermined to be done. As soon as you talk that language, it just free will is gone. It's gone. You can't. It's a ridiculous idea. This is God getting ahead of everybody and everything, ensuring that his purpose comes to pass. He's glorified. The Lord Jesus Christ is glorified. As we talked last week about, like, this was it. This was what the world was created for. This was the fullness of time. Christ said, my hour has come. And this was it. And we know, again, as we spoke of last week, that period of time when sin was imputed to Christ and the Father poured out his wrath, Christ in the hands of an angry God, Christ propitiated for those sins, for his people because his love, his forelove, his relation of affection set on them before time resulted in him entering in this covenant, following through primarily for the Father, sacrificed to the Father so that he could redeem these people for their glory to result in our salvation. Perfect plan. The God that cannot lie set that plan up in wisdom and perfection, and nothing was wrong with it. And people can object to it, look at it, argue about it, and they're always wanting to insert themselves in it and argue against it being grace. They can do that up until judgment. And they will hear, "Depart from me, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you." And those are some of the people we're going to be talking about next few weeks that will cause us to say and to see, "Thank you, God, that I am not in that crowd. I know it's by grace and mercy. I very well could have been." So I think the next few weeks will be very helpful when we start talking about double predestination, the love and hate of God. Not just going to talk about how that God hates some people, but we're going to prove out by that how God loves people in the first place again, so we can have that contrasting idea. And again, a bunch more new set of terms and definitions and explanations and things that we'll be looking at. So you're going to have to try to keep all these things in your head. I know it's not the easiest thing to do, especially after I just kind of like dropped that bomb on everybody that sometimes words and phrases and stuff float around and you have to be flexible and identify them and they overlap. And it's a job to try to, you know, roll with it. Any questions or comments? Was everything understandable? Again, any questions? Eric? All right, I'm just trying to get some questions on here. That's all. All right. Patrick? Got anything?
No.
All right.